Okay, so this is where we left off in 53 on the second section. So diversity and trophic structure characterize biological communities. So let's look at what these things are. In general, a few species in a community exert strong control on that particular community's structures. So two fundamental features of community structure are species diversity. So we're going to talk about each one of these individually, and the feeding relationships among organisms in the community. So remember, a community is a group of different populations living together in a particular area. So species diversity of a community is the variety of organisms that make up the community. So the more different types of organisms you have, the more diverse the community is. It has two components, species, what we call species richness and relative abundance. So this one is species richness. It's the number of different species in a community. And then this one is relative abundance. The proportion of each species represents is the proportion each species represents of all individuals in the community. So you can have the different communities that exhibit different richnesses and abundances. So if we look here, each one of these communities, they call them just species A, B, C, and D on here. So if we look here, this right here, it's hard to see. See, this is B, the light tree. There's one B right here. These are all A's. This is a C. And these two are D's. So you can see that they have the, if we look at the diversity, they're not equal. They have the same number of different species in the community. So they have the same species richness. They both have A, B, C, and D, those organisms. But look at the proportion of each species is not the same. This one has way more A and very few others, all right? So 5%, 5%, and 10%. So that's what it means by proportion is the percentage compared to the total, the number compared to the total, and so you get a percentage, whereas this has equal distribution of 25% each. So we can say that the two communities can have the same species richness, the same number of types of or different types of organisms, but a different relative abundance. And so that's why each one of those is important. So really this one's a little bit more diverse because this one, the whole community is made up of 80% one particular type of organism. So it's not just the number of different species, but the proportion. And we are going to skip this part here. So we don't need to know about, for the AP test, the Shannon Diversity Index. And actually, we're going to go all the way up to communities here. So we're going to cross out all the way here. All right, so that's pretty exciting. Communities with higher diversity are, so what are true, all right? They are more productive. They produce more biomass. Bio is the mass of living things, so the total mass of all organisms. They're more stable in their productivity. They're better able to withstand and recover from environmental stresses, and they're more resistant to invasive species. Remember, organisms that become established outside of their native range. So it's good to be a more diverse community in both species richness and relative abundance. Now the second thing, a feature of community was diversity, but then the second one is the feeding relationship. So that's what we're going to look at next. This thing called trophic structure is the feeding relationships between organisms in the community. It's a key factor in community dynamics. So food chains, you probably remember, hopefully, food chains from biology, link trophic levels from producers to top carnivores. These guys eat meat. These guys produce their own food, usually through photosynthesis, and most living organisms on Earth. There are a few that exceptions that produce their own food from chemicals, like on the bottom of the ocean, where there's no sunlight. All right, so here we have the feeding relationships. So here we have two food chains. So a terrestrial, which means land, and a marine, which is the ocean. This is land. All right, so we start out with a plant. These guys are primary producers. Producers mean they produce their own food through photosynthesis. Primary means first. Well, really, in a food chain, there is really only one you don't have a secondary producer. So those are primary producers. And so those are always at the bottom of the food chain. And so in the ocean, that's phytoplankton. Plankton are free-floating organisms. They don't swim. And phyto means that they're plant-like. So they do photosynthesis. So these are your producers. And then this arrow here, the direction of the arrow is important. This is the direction of energy flow. So the energy from this is going to go to this. And the reason why is because this is eaten by this. So you can think of the arrow as it going into the other organism's mouth. All right, so they eat them. And so these guys are the primary consumers. Why? They're the first consumers in our food chain. And consumer means they consume their food. They have to eat it. So you have your two primary consumers. Then we go up to these guys are eaten by these guys. And these are your secondary consumers, tertiary means three, and quaternary means four. All right, so on the outside, you can also have names for these. So this, the grasshopper can be called an herbivore if it eats only plants. The mouse is a carnivore, all right, if it eats only animals, and so this is acting as a carnivore and carnivore, okay? And so, so that's what those mean. But these right here are your trophic levels. And so all organisms are part of one level here or can be part of multiple levels. So they can be act as a primary consumer as well as a secondary consumer because most organisms fit in more than one food chain and for the ecosystem. So that brings us to the point of a food web. So a food web is a branching food chain with complex trophic interactions. And so here you have many food chains that make up this one food web. And you can see that organisms can eat and get their energy from multiple sources. So these birds here, like this little penguin here, can eat the krill, can eat the copepods, or the carnivorous plankton, or the fishes, or the squids, all right? So therefore, it can eat lots of different organisms and therefore be in different trophic levels. So if we follow from the phytoplankton to the copepods, all right, so here, primary producer, primary consumer, and then if we go here, it's acting as a secondary consumer. But it can also act as there's primary consumer or primary producer, primary consumer, secondary consumer going this way, tertiary consumer. So depending upon what food chain and what it's feeding off of, it can have multiple kind of roles in acting as a consumer and what level of consumer and so on. So species may play a role at more than one trophic level, okay? Now, food webs can be simplified by grouping species with similar trophic relationships into broad functional groups, isolating a portion of the community that interacts very little with the rest of the community. So if what we're saying is taking and just looking at the birds or something like that, a portion of the community instead of the whole big food web for the whole community itself, just looking at part of it. All right, and so this would be an example of a part of a larger food web. So then notice here that it doesn't go beyond quaternary consumers. So we don't have a fifth or sixth or seventh level. Let's talk about why that is. So this is limits on food chain length. Each food chain in a food web is usually only a few links long. The energetic hypothesis suggests that length is limited by inefficient energy transfer. In fact, only about, and this is an estimate, only about 10% of the energy stored in organic matter at each trophic level is converted to organic matter at the next trophic level. So let's give an example. A producer level consists of 100 grams of plant material and can support about 10 grams of herbivore biomass and only 1 gram of carnivore. So this is the producer. So if we go producer to your herbivore, all right, to your carnivore. So this is your, this is your kind of food chain, producer to herbivore to carnivore. This has 100 kilograms of plant mass. This has 10 kilograms. This is 1 kilogram of plant mass. That's what it's saying here. It can only support, only 10% of the energy is transferred from one level to the next. So only 10 is 10% of 100. So it can also be tested by manipulating the productivity. Before I talk about that, let's just look over here. So when we look here, however much energy is here in this in the plant, only 10% is transferred, all right? So, therefore, 10% transferred. And so where does the other energy go, that 90%? Well, some of it's used by the plant, and some of it's wasted as heat energy and given off as heat. And so that's where the other energy goes, and so only 10% is transferred. All right, so let's look at this. So this can be tested by manipulating productivity. For example, researchers varied the amount of leaf litter available to consumers in tree hole communities and measured the number of links in the food chain. So if you look at this next page, we did an experiment. They did an experiment where they took a tree where a branch falls off and gets a little scar where the branch was, and that rots out, so you end up having a hole in the tree, and that collects water and leaves and so on, and a whole little ecosystem can live in there. All these different little organisms and so on can live and use the leaf litter as for an energy source. And so what they did is they did an experiment in Australia, actually, where they put different amounts of leaf litter, high, medium, and low, and then looked at the food chains and the number of links, the trophic links, so how long, basically, that means how long the food chain is. And so the more energy or the more leaf litter you were supplied, the larger the food chain. And so therefore the low had the lowest. And so that shows proves and supports this energetic hypothesis that the length is limited by inefficient energy transfer and so on. So another reason why you have not very many links in the food chain is that the quaternary structures, the consumers up here, are usually very, very big. And so, therefore, there's just not enough energy to be transferred. If there was something above that, realizing that only 10% is transferred from organism to organism, there's just not enough energy to support those another link. There just wouldn't be enough energy transfer there. Okay. So, in an ecosystem, there are certain species that have a bigger impact on the ecosystem as a whole than others. So species with a large impact. Certain species have a very large impact on community structure. Such species are highly abundant, so there's a lot of them, or they don't have to have a lot of them, just play a pivotal role in community dynamics. So we call this a dominant species. Are those most abundant or have the highest biomass? So that is the species that are highly abundant. So we're going to look at each one of these. This one, highly abundant, and this one, we haven't yet talked about that one down here. So the dominant species are those that are most abundant or have the highest biomass. One hypothesis suggests that the dominant species are most competitive in exploiting resources. So another hypothesis is that they're the most successful at avoiding predators. So invasive species, typically introduced to a new environment by humans, may become dominant because they lack predators or disease. And so there's nothing to kill them, so therefore they reproduce and so on and kind of take over the area and use the resources that the native species would normally use, which affects the native species. One way to discover the impact of a dominant species is to remove it from the community. So if you remove the dominant species from the community, you can see really what its role was. So an example is the introduction of chestnut blight into eastern North America, killing most of the dominant American chestnut trees. Chestnut blight was a fungus it was in the early 1900s, around 1910, where it killed most of the dominant American chestnut trees. So that was the dominant species where the forest was dominated by these chestnut trees, and the fungus wiped out a good portion of them. So removal of the dominant species had a small impact on some species and a large or severe effect on others. So what happens is other tree species began to, there was more room and so on and more resources. So oaks, hickories, beeches, and red maples increased in abundance. So they increased as a result, but other organisms, moth and butterfly, there were 7 moth and butterfly species that fed on the trees that became extinct, the chestnut trees. And so therefore, those guys died out. And so that's an example of the severe effect on other species. And so that is that you can see just the role of that dominant species when it was taken out by that chestnut blight. So that's what that means, removing it from the community. So it's not ideal to remove it, but when it does happen, we can see its effect. The second type of species that has a large impact on the community is called a keystone species. Exert strong control on a community by their ecological roles or niches. So in contrast to the dominant species, they are not necessarily abundant. So there doesn't necessarily have to be a lot of them in the community. So an example is the study of sea stars and their role as keystone species in intertidal communities. All right, the sea stars we're going to see here eat mussels. This is some. And I should say here that the mussels are a dominant species in this community. Okay, so what happened here? So here's the sea star, and right here is the mussel. Mussels are a bivalve. They are like clams. The shell opens and closes like this. And so what happens is the sea star is going around, wrapping its body around that mussel, and it pries that open and eats the mussel inside. So anyway, so notice here the graph is over time, and this was an experiment done. This is disaster, that's the sea star. And this is the number of species present, all right? So this is your species richness. That's another word for that, remember? And so, excuse me. So what they found is that the sea star eats the mussels, all right? And with the sea star present eating the mussels, species richness and the number of species present stays high. All right, so you have a high amount of species present in the intertidal zone where they live. But look at what happens when this experimenter took out the sea star. So when they took out the sea star, it's no longer eating the mussels. What happened is then the mussels became overpopulated, started eating everything else, and look at what happened is the species richness or the number of species went down without that sea star. So therefore, the sea star is an example of a keystone species, not because it's a wide abundance, like not because there's so many sea stars in this community, but that they play a pivotal role in maintaining the mussel population, which then has an effect on the rest of the community. So without that one organism, even though there's few of them, without that one organism, it has disastrous effects on the whole community. And so that is what we deem a keystone species. Now, some species are called ecosystem engineers because they cause actual physical changes in the community, in the environment that affect community structure. So beavers are an example of an ecosystem engineer because they can transform landscapes by, building dams and pooling water and so on. And so they can have a big effect on their community. All right. And so they are considered ecosystem engineers. And so here's a little picture here of some beavers. Aren't they cute? Alrighty, so then you're going to get excited here because we're going to skip this part. Alright, we don't need to know that for the exam, so we're going to skip that. So let's turn the page. And this part here has to do with that original part as well, so we're going to skip that. So we're going to go right on to the third section. Disturbance influences species diversity in composition. So if there's a disturbance to the environment, decades ago, most ecologists favored the view that communities are in a state of equilibrium. This view was supported by this man named Clements, who suggested that biotic interactions cause species in a climax community to function as a superorganism. And then two other guys, Tansley and Gleason, challenged whether communities were actually in equilibrium. They viewed communities as chance assemblages of species with similar abiotic requirements, so similar food, water requirements, and they just were living together by chance. And so let's look at what happens here. A disturbance is an event that changes a community, removes organisms from it, and alters resource availability. So a fire would be an example of that. The recent emphasis on the role of change has produced what we call a non-equilibrium model, that communities are not in equilibrium, which describes communities as constantly changing after disturbances. So disturbances happen, and then they're continually changing and adapting after those disturbances. So let's look at kind of classifying or characterizing disturbances, the types of disturbances and their frequency, how often they occur, and how severe they are, vary among communities. You know what? I forgot that I wanted to skip this part here. So we're skipping a lot here. We're going to skip through the picture here, but we're going to talk about Yellowstone. So the large-scale fire in Yellowstone Park demonstrated that communities can often respond very rapidly to a very massive disturbance. We're going to talk about a fire here in just a second. The Yellowstone Forest is an example of a non-equilibrium community. Not in equilibrium. So this is with the equilibrium model. So we're going to go right from here to here. And we're going to write a few things about this fire. All right. So so Yellowstone is dominated by a type of tree called a lodgepole pine, which requires, I'll put in parentheses, periodic fires. And I'll talk about why that is. So let's look at that. The cones remain closed until exposed to intense heat. So they stay closed, and then when the heat of the fire causes those cones to open, and inside those cones are seeds. So the next one, so when a forest fire burns the trees, so during, let's say, a forest fire, the cones open and seeds are dispersed. Then what happens is then the seeds come out, and the new generation thrives on the nutrients released from the burned trees. I'm getting off the thing, aren't I? Burned trees. And the sun that is no longer blocked by the big trees. Tall, I should say, trees. All right, and so therefore, that's the natural life cycle of the lodgepole pine, which is a major species, a dominant species in Yellowstone. So I do want to point out that some ecosystems rely on disturbances to maintain the ecosystem, and the Yellowstone Park is an example of that. And this picture here shows you a before and after of soon after the fire, all right, and the devastation, and 1 year after the fire, what's going on here, all right, and so on. So you can see that things are starting to grow back. Okay, so now let's look at how ecosystems change over time naturally due to some disturbances. So this is called succession. So ecological succession is the sequence of community changes after a disturbance. So primary succession occurs where no soil exists when succession begins. So that means that's primary means first. So it's the first time organisms gonna live there. So early arriving species and later arriving species may be linked in one of three processes. Early arrivals may facilitate the appearance of later species by making the environment favorable. They may inhibit the establishment of later species, and they may tolerate later species but have no impact on their establishment. So let's go through some examples of this. Retreating glaciers are an example of this. So the glacier retreats and exposes the land underneath it. So it provides a valuable field research opportunity for observing primary succession, because when it retreats, it exposes land that nothing has lived on there before. So succession on the moraines of Glacier Bay, Alaska, allows a predictable pattern of change in vegetation and soil characteristics. So the exposed moraine, the exposed land, is colonized by what we call pioneering plants, because they pioneer or are the first ones there, including liverworts, mosses, fireweed, dryas, and willows. So let's look at, this is lichen. You probably have seen it. It can grow on rocks. So it is actually involved in making soil. Its little hair-like root structures can get into cracks and crevices of rocks and start to form soil. And over time, as it dies, it adds nutrients to the soil and so on. So you can have primary succession occur where nothing has lived before, and even on rocks. So like, for instance, a volcanic island that is formed by underwater volcanoes like the Galapagos Islands had no soil there, and then organisms, the pioneer species like lichen, can help to make soil by breaking up that rock, and over millions of years, that gradual rock and things dying and adding nutrients to the soil forms a nice topsoil. So this is Glacier Bay, Alaska, and this is the retreating glacier that exposes the moraine. So this is the exposure here, and these guys are the pioneer species that are begin to grow. Then we have next, it's a little larger species begin to overtake it, the Dryas. And then we get the elder stage, which are some trees. And then our last stage is the spruce stage. The spruce shades out the elder, and the elder die off, and the spruce take hold of it. And usually that's the end stage here, so that you get your community at the very end. And that collectively, that process here is called primary succession. And the first plant was the primary pioneer plant. So let's look at here. So mosses were part of that. Lichen is an example. Then is the picture I just showed. This is the picture I just showed. So then you have your Dryas, elder, and spruce stage. So succession is the result of changes induced by the vegetation itself. So on the glacial moraines, pioneer plant species facilitate later arrivals by increasing soil nitrogen content. So when they die, they produce nitrogen, put nitrogen back into the soil, and then plants can take it up and use it to build proteins and so on. And so you can see here the soil nitrogen, very small in the pioneer stage, but as we get to the spruce stage, much greater, and so therefore can support larger plants, a larger variety of plants. And that's primary succession. The next one is called secondary succession. Begins in an area where soil remains after a disturbance. For example, an abandoned agricultural land may return to its original state through secondary succession. So you have, so this could be like the Yellowstone example, where the fire comes and then you have new organisms grow after that. So humans have the greatest impact on biological communities. Both terrestrial and marine ecosystems are subject to marine disturbances. Human disturbances to communities usually reduces species diversity. So we can have disturbances like a forest fire, not in Yellowstone, but a forest fire that would then get rid of or kill most of the organisms in which then secondary succession would take place, where the land had something living on it, and we had to grow new things, all right, on it. So that's secondary succession. When we look at another example here of human disturbances that I just want to talk about here, is one example is trawling. That is this here, where you take nets and you pull it along the boats, and it collects all the species there. And that has really affected the ecosystem in some areas. So you can see diversity before trawling and after trawling. And so that has been a big deal in some areas. And the last thing here is about how latitude is, the equator is 0 degrees, and then we have latitude lines that go up by 30 degrees south, 30 degrees north, and so on. So that's your latitude. And we find that diversity, there's a correlation between latitude and diversity. So latitude and area are two key factors in affecting a community species diversity. So latitudinal gradients. Species richness, just talked about that earlier, is especially great in the tropics and generally declines along the equatorial polar gradient. So as you go up here, diversity decreases. And two factors that play a role in that are evolutionary history and climate. So temperate and polar communities. Temperate, tropical is usually in this area between 0 and 30 degrees near the equator. Temperate's kind of in the middle. We live in a temperate climate, and polar is near the poles. So temperate and polar communities have started over repeatedly following glaciation. So when the glaciations were made, then melted, and made, and melted, and so on. And so they've started over repeatedly. So the greater age of tropical environments, that has not happened in near the equator. The greater age of tropical environments may account for the greater species richness. They have had more time in history. In the tropics, the growing season is longer. You don't have the winter where growing stops. So biological time runs faster. You have more time that those species can evolve and so on and so forth, and speciation can occur. So climate is the likely primary cause of the gradient of biodiversity and why it gets less diverse as you go towards the poles. Two main climatic factors correlated with biodiversity are sunlight and precipitation. So how much water and how much sun seems to be play a role. And so together we measure this by measuring what's called evapotranspiration. The evaporation of water from soil plus transpiration of water from plants. So remember, on the underside of the leaf, there are little openings that pores called stomata that open and close. And when they open to allow gas exchange for photosynthesis and cellular respiration, water escapes and evaporates out of there. So that's evapotranspiration, what comes out of the soil plus the plants. And so in warmer climates, the evapotranspiration as well as the sunlight and warmth, the more you have of each one of those. So evapotranspiration here, as it increases, notice here species richness goes up. And so there's a correlation between that. And that's where I want to end, because we are actually going to, that's the end of what I need to do for chapter 53. So we're going to get rid of this and this. All right? And so that is chapter 53, and we are finished.